and proudly call two parents father. I shall never leave you, father. I shall always be with you, father. We all love you very much. Please give us one more chance to prove it. You have suffered enough. You have suffered more than you deserve to. Let us take your burden, Father. We are very fortunate here in Las Vegas. We are fortunate beyond our wildest dreams. We have the opportunity to hear directly from the true children. Please rise. Please rise as we accept and prepare for the words that will be coming forth from our most beloved Kwon Jin Nim. I give you Kwon Jin Nim!
Yeah!
Thank you. Thank you. Please be seated. Can everyone hear me okay? There we go. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My goodness, there's so much to cover today. But before we begin, I'd just like to take a moment to acknowledge all the wonderful, hardworking Japanese missionaries. Actually, can I have them all come up? All the Japanese missionaries, can they come up for a second? Can you line up here, please? This isn't all of them, but these are the wonderful missionaries that have been helping us out. I just wanted to really point out the hard work that they've been doing. We are sad to say that we will be sending back two wonderful missionaries, Chie and of course Suzuki-san. They'll be leaving on Thursday and Wednesday. That's even sooner. But I would like to just acknowledge them because these are the wonderful faces and that'll continue to come here to Vegas. But these are the wonderful faces and these are the people who have really worked and prayed to really uplift this community. And I want to just take this moment to just recognize and thank all of them for their hard work. Thank you. You know, when I first got here, there were Japanese missionaries, and you know, they really didn't have a direction or a goal. And now, you know, they're starting something new, which is wonderful. They're starting a system, and we've now communicated with the wonderful leadership that we're receiving from Japan, but also Kim Yo-sung, who is the den mother of the Japanese missionaries. They've been working very hard together to create a system. A witnessing system. So it is not only wonderful service events like Shining City, but actual witnessing and then, you know, speaking of divine principle. And as we continue to grow as a congregation, we'll continue to add more and more events to our schedule to include more and more younger people and more of an active outreach on UNLV. So it's a very exciting and wonderful tradition that was started here in Las Vegas under the tutelage of Kim Yo-sung and, of course, Suzuki-sung. So I thank them all because the work that they have done will live on after they move on. Kim Yo-sung, hopefully you'll be here for a lot longer than that. But thank you very much to all of them. And I'd just like to acknowledge a couple of other people really quickly. Just Hope, thank you so much for all of your witnessing. And please continue to do all your wonderful hard work. And of course, that goes for all of you as well. Thank you so much for honoring the wishes of our true mother and really putting a good face out there. And that really brings me to today's sermon. You know, it's kind of bittersweet for me. Because I actually couldn't sleep last night because I realized, my goodness, it's been 30 years since the Day of Victory of Love. And I realized for a lot of younger blessed children or newer members, they don't understand what that means. And, You know, it was celebrated very quietly in Korea, but it's a very significant milestone in our church history. But before I begin, I would like to show a quick video that was put together by Reverend Du of the face who started the Day of Victory of Love. Thank you, Reverend Du. That was lovely. This speech was given by Father January 15th, 1984, translated at Belvedere by Boi Pak. And he spoke about my brother Heung Jung's passing. At the time of Jesus' crucifixion, there were two thieves hanging on the cross. One on Jesus' left and the one on the right. By divine principle, we know that the one on the right represented the free world to come, and the one on the left represented the communist world. The one on the left was scornful and said, "If you really are the Son of God, why don't you get down from here and save us all?" At the time of Heung Jin's accident, two other blessed children were with him. They survived, and they are now in good condition. They were driving on Route 9, and a big truck was traveling in the opposite lane. The driver of the truck threw on his brakes to avoid a patch of ice, but his trailer jackknifed into their lane. Normally, such a situation would have caused great damage to the person on the front passenger seat, but Heung Jin had just enough time to turn the car so that the fullest brunt of the impact was on his side. When those two boys, Jinbok and Jingil, got out of the hospital, they gave testimony in tears that Heung Jin had died on their behalf. He could easily turn the other way to protect himself, but they reported that he deliberately took the impact to save them. Heung Jin was truly born to save others, which he did even at the moment of his death. Thus, the fact that he sacrificed himself for the other two boys is symbolic of the fact that he sacrificed himself for the sake of the world. Abel is always in the position of to be sacrificed, and Heung Jin never feared that possibility. In fact, he virtually volunteered for it. Jesus and the two thieves were all crucified. But in the case of Heung Jin, he died and the two representatives of the world survived, healthy and strong. Jinbok and Jingil had often testified that Heung Jin was always saying, "I love my father, and he is in danger. I am in a position to protect him, and I'm ready to die to do that." Those two boys lost their father many years ago. Because of that, Heung Jin always loved them very much and felt a fatherly heart towards them. Because Heung Jin paved the way, we now have a wide open door to save the communist and free world. He sacrificed himself on the national foundation level for the sake of the forthcoming unity between the democratic and communist worlds. The accident occurred in the Western world where he was buried, but he was buried in Korea. Thus, his body is linked to both worlds. His body returned to his homeland, which was the national foundation, and he died for the sake of the world. Since he was living on the victorious national foundation, and he died on that foundation, he will be able to travel back and forth from the spirit world. He will be able to work here on the national level and move on to the worldwide level. There is a far greater foundation made for the land of settlement than in the time of Jesus. Now the doors towards the salvation of humanity has been opened far wider because Heung Jin's great sacrifice. Even Jesus could not establish the national level because he could not establish the true parents. But Heung Jin had true parents who laid a national foundation for him to inherit. This is why Heung Jin's sacrifice brought back the situation of the two thieves being crucified next to Jesus. It was their resurrection. Even though many sacrifices have been made by our church elders in the past, such as Mr. Yu and Mr. Lee, and also many other children who died, they were sacrificed only on the church level. For the first time, a sacrifice was made on the national level by Heung Jin. This is the reason why he became a commander-in-chief in the spirit world and the physical world, moving freely back and forth. Since Heung Jin was unmarried, his death had another significance. At this time, the spirit world is an unmarried realm and will remain so until the true parents go there. He has become the commander-in-chief of all those unmarried men and women in the spirit world. For that reason, I told Heung Jin not to worry about being unmarried. I will provide him with an adopted son here on earth. That means he shall receive the blessing as well. Heung Jin took all the blame for the Unification Church by dying for that purpose. He has freed everybody else. Therefore, his contribution touches not only our church, but also the free world and the communist world. All those people will come to love Heung Jin. He loved the world and proved it by becoming a conditional sacrifice for the world. And for that reason, the rest of the Unification Church must also love the world. He died in my place. Therefore, your love for him must manifest itself for your love for me. Before this, the spirit world had no way to connect true parents. But because Heung Jin is a direct representative, they can now connect. Also, they can connect themselves to the Unification Church because he died for you too. Here on earth, Heung Jin showed the example of loving his fellow man unto his life. Likewise, for the love of his father, he died for the sake of the world, knowing that his father could continue to live for the sake of the world. By loving Heung Jin in the spirit world, those men and women can connect with the true parents on earth. Therefore, his entry into the world, into that world, was a great and joyful day. He came as the Messiah of love for the spirit world. Heung Jin set the example for martyrdom for our church. The spirit world and the physical world will be loving him. The true parents' position has been that of willingness and joyfulness to contribute their beloved son for their great benefit of the spirit and physical world. God never had a chance to love Adam and Eve, who fell as teenagers. Now this pure, unmarried teenage son had been lifted up into the spirit world. This is the first time such a gift could be given to God that he might love such an unstained child. Therefore, I told God I would not feel sadness for myself, but rather repentance. That when I was a teenager, I could not love Korea enough, that there wasn't enough foundation at that time. But now,
with the sacrifice of my son for the world, I have fulfilled my responsibility for the nation of Korea and for the world. Those things which I myself could not do in the past can now be received by God through Heung Jin's sacrifice. In the spirit world, the physical world, and the true parents are loving Heung Jin. Upon the total sacrifice of Heung Jin for the sake of the two passengers in that car, which symbolizes the free and communist world, I am proclaiming that he obtained the victory of love. I will now physically save the free world and the communist world. Furthermore, I'm declaring the resurrection of love. In this way, the realm of death has no more power. That is why I declared the funeral of Heung Jin should be entirely different from any others. It would be a joyful celebration, even like a wedding day. Furthermore, I declared the day a victory of love. I never had time to think in terms of my own son dying, but rather how victorious would benefit God and hurt Satan's realm. Thus, I concentrated upon making many conditions to lead into making the declaration of that day a victory of love. Instead of thinking in terms of our departed son, mother and I centered upon the dispensation of God. In the hospital, I held the unification ceremony for the overall benefit. I pledged to God that the true parents would remain regally proud and that the entire spirit world and physical world would recognize the true parents and praise them due to this victory of love. The entire world would proclaim the true parents. You are the true center of God's love. The day of victory of love is that day in which true parents have reached a new level and are marching forward upon the foundation of Heung Jin's sacrifice. Therefore, I said to Mother, this is not the time to shed tears. This is actually a moment of glory for God and humanity. Particularly during the funeral time, you are not in the position to shed tears. I admonished her not to shed tears in public. Privately, as a loving mother, she will shed many tears. We have maintained Heung Jin's room in East Garden just as it was. His brothers and sisters have all wanted to go into there to sleep and study since he passed on. There is a powerful attraction for them in that room. Thus, the power and attractiveness of Heung Jin, the power and attractiveness that Heung Jin had for young people is already being manifested. The day of victory of love is the most significant day in our movement. You too must manifest the true love of God in your deeds. Without a truly loving spirit, you cannot be worthy of this special day. I will not shed any tears over the loss of Heung Jin through the whole time of the funeral. It was only when Colonel Park came back from Korea and reported about the victorious proceedings there that I finally broke down and shed tears for my son. I'm a public man, and therefore must be stern with myself. Through this event, the Unification Church will never be weakened, but will leap forward. The great sacrifice will bring about greater victories from now on, centering on the true parents and upon the declaration of the day of victory of love. Vindication will come to us all. As long as you love the true parents more than you love anything else, you will overcome Satan. The power of love will be your vindication because Heung Jin died for all of us and he opened the door so that everyone can be entitled to the privilege of love. Now your duty is to love the true parents even more than Heung Jin did. If you have this as your criterion, the power of death will no more, and Satan will retreat. Up until now, Satan was able to conquer and control love, but from now on, love shall be governed by God. This is a great day, great day. Do you follow? If you listen again to these points, you will understand these profound truths which I am telling you. Because I am telling you the power of love is now able to conquer the power of death. Upon this foundation, I declared the day of victory of love. The satanic world will crumble faster now, but the speed will be determined by you. The faster you move, the faster they will crumble. This is your responsibility. This is the time for you to be running day and night doing God's work. Even though you may feel you're about to die during these years, don't worry. If you die yourself, you will not die physically, but you will see that in 3 years your resurrection will come to this nation and even the world.
After 3 years of Jesus' mission, he gained his individual resurrection, which we are bringing. He gained his individual resurrection. We are bringing the national resurrection, and we shall move forward to that goal and achieve the great victory. Amen?
Amen.
Of course, everyone will die physically someday. But you won't have to die in the satanic realm. You will die in the heavenly realm. Our new tradition for funeral and burial is different from the secular world and even from the Christian world. Now that you know the importance of the day of victory of love, your determination must be to gain inspiration from Heung Jin and even go beyond his accomplishments. He will be with you, helping you. If you tell him, Heung Jin, I am going to surpass even your standard, he will be pleased. He will say, go right ahead. That is a very different standard to surpass, but that must be your goal. If you dedicated to that goal, please raise your hands. Heung Jin will thank you for that. Spirit world is right here with us. So Heung Jin is here as well. By the declaration of the Day of Victory of Love, even Jesus Christ has gained greater freedom to come down to this world on the national level. The entire Christian world has been liberated as well. Due to the Day of Victory of Love, Esau is freed to love Jacob. Cain can love Abel. Previously, great indemnity had to be paid by Abel in order to love Cain. Cain was never in a position to love Abel, even though he might have wanted to, because of satanic forces were always dictating to Cain whom he could love. But now the love of God has come down and Cain can freely love Abel. In other words, Satan's power over love has been greatly diminished. Your world is changing. You can feel it and you can see it, even in the media. Great changes are coming. The springtime of love is upon us. When spring comes, most people think about having a picnic, but a conscientious farmer will use his time to sprinkle in new seeds. That is what we're going to do. Because we are different from the secular world, we are going to work in the springtime to plant the seeds of God's love in the hearts of men. These next 3 years will be our time for planting God's love. Everywhere we go, we will have that consciousness. Shall we do it?
Yes.
It's a tough thing to talk about. It's been 30 years since my brother passed. He was born in the year of the horse. Anyone here born in the year of the horse? Any hands?
Yay.
You? Only one? Well, Happy New Year to everybody, and this year is, oh God, awful. terrible year to be born in. I'm just kidding, Claudelina. Well, in the Chinese New Year, this year is the year of the horse, meaning that my brother would have been 48 years old this year, which is pretty amazing to think about it, because he passed away at such a very young age. He was only 18 when he passed. And, you know, and he very much embodied the spirit of the year of the horse. The year, people who are born in the year of the horse, they're okay. But like the animal itself, they're wild and they're carefree and they're gallant and they're very charismatic and they're things of beauty. And they're very charismatic creatures, and certainly people born in that year share those traits, and certainly my brother did as well. The hardest part for me was trying to really, I don't want to tell so much anecdotal stories about him, but I really wanted to share the essence of who he was. Because Father put it very clearly, he said, we have to attain his level, Heung Jin's level of consciousness, to really embrace the world. So what kind of a brother was Heung Jin? I mean, to me, he was almost a godlike figure. He was truly, I mean, talking to some members who knew him back in the day, and I go, hey, I was talking to, we have a lot of interesting people in our church. And there's this really, Yeah, there's a real tough black lady that, man, we all grew up with. Her name is Lisa from Englewood, New Jersey, and she was like a Black Panther in the 70s. She's just a tough broad. But, you know, when I asked her about my brother, she would just pause and go, yeah. Because both of them shared a love of animals. And, you know, when I look back at in my life, the things that I enjoy so much, the reason why, my God, I'm horribly addicted to speed, why I love driving fast, why I love motorcycles, why I love animals so much is because of, really because of my brother. He would embrace life at full throttle. But he wasn't reckless. There was this one horse that Lisa was talking about that would buck and kick everybody. And his name was Blaze. And I remember, you know, Heung Jin Nim, my older brother who also passed away, he would meet people, events in life with a head-on collision. He would just hit it with his head and knock the other person or event out. He was like a ramrod in a sense. And Lisa described my brother Heung Jin, he had that same spirit, but he was more like a violin. He had this elegance about him and had this wonderful fragility and yet this incredible toughness. He was the only one that could actually talk to the horses while everybody else was, you know, at the barn at Berrytown doing other things. He would be there in the barn with the horses. And then when everyone would jump on the horses and go for a ride, he would be in the barn just playing with the baby kittens that were just born and taking care of them. He always thought of the things that other people took for granted. He was the most thoughtful and conscientious person I've ever met. He's also one of the most accomplished artists I've ever seen. His engravings and pictures actually adorn, Chumpyong. They're quite prophetic and very profound. He had such a wonderful eye for beauty. And I would remember he would get on this horse, Blaze, and it was the only horse that he would ride bareback. No one else could. And, you know, when you first get on a horse, you know, it's a very intimidating thing because you're riding 2,000 pounds of muscle. And he would go bareback and go galloping down a hill at full throttle with his arms outstretched and just feeling just the total freedom. And we would look at him like he was a godlike figure. It was incomprehensible that he drove with absolutely no security whatsoever. And, you know, when talking to more and more members and recounting these stories, they go, you know, that is really the essence of who he was. As a young boy, he was obsessed with protecting father. It was his life goal. It was the reason why, you know, growing up as a kid, if you were to come up to an 8-year-old me and ask me what I wanted to do when I grew up, I would say I wanted to be a secret serviceman for my father. Because he would do this, he would test the security at East Garden all the time. And he would gather up blessed children and they would try to assault the fences. And it was just an amazing time because everybody around him, all blessed children included, they just wanted to be with him because he had absolutely no filter in enjoying life at all. And he had absolutely no filter whatsoever when it came to sharing the passion of living life. I mean, blessed children in his room it became almost a joke. If he saw you looking at maybe a figurine or maybe a picture that he drew or a book or some or even a cup of some kind, and if he just caught you looking at it, he would ask you, "Do you like that?" Yeah, it's very nice. Go ahead, you can have it. He would give everything away, and the joke was, it came to a point where the blessed children that knew him, they would go in his room, they don't look at anything, don't look at anything. And whenever there was a new person there, they knew that he would give something to them, and they would tell him the rules. When you go into his room, don't look at anything. Say you don't like anything in his room. But it was a wonderful spirit. It captured the spirit and the energy. You know, I mean, Lisa was telling me that there was a time, 5 o'clock in the morning, where she was staying in the dorm at Berrytown, and she would hear something at her window on her third floor window, and she would hear rocks being thrown at her window. She would come up 5 a.m. and look down and see Heung Jin on a horse with maybe Heung Jin or one of the brothers. You know, they drove up 3 a.m. just so they could ride horses all day and then be back by Sunday service for her father. I mean, things like that. And they're like, Lisa, come on down. We're going to go riding. And she's like, okay. And there was a wonderful beauty about the spirit that he embodied, because the sadness that came over Lisa was, even at that time, she had to take a picture of him, and she has this picture of just him riding on Blaze with absolutely no saddle, and she took a picture before she went down, because she knew then, you know, as a relatively young new member, as a 20-year-old member, that my God, this moment is so precious. There's no way this could last. And it was quite profound. People, the blessed children and the members that were with him in his room, my God, you know, he used to live in a world of fantasy and fairy tales. And if you're an older person like me, and if you're a nerd, before the internet and before you had video games at home, you had to entertain yourself, and they played Dungeons and Dragons. And if you know what that means, then you're just as nerdy as I am. And he would hold these tournaments and these events where, you know, the world of Dungeons and Dragons, it was like the Lord of the Rings, in a sense. It was just a mystical world, and he would concoct these incredible stories. And the blessed, we would be up awake for days. I would be, my character would have been killed off in 2 seconds, but I would love to sit there, and we would just gorge ourselves on large pepperoni Irvington pizzas and liters of Sunkist, and we would be immersed in this world of fantasy and magic and dragons, and it was the most incredible, spiritually uplifting time, because everybody there, they knew how amazing this moment was, because what he embodied was this spirit of complete acceptance. It was the only time that I remember that blessed children ever felt completely united with somebody. And I remember the biggest thing about Heung Jin was whenever father was around, he would never leave his side. You know, during the many fishing trips up to Gloucester, where father would have, you know, be fishing for tuna, sometimes, you know, the weather in New England is awful. And I would remember just this image of him is seared on my in my brain of, you know, we would be out in the middle of a horrible storm, 9-foot waves. It'll be in the middle of the summer, but you couldn't see anything because the whole sky was black and the water was black and people were vomiting and the smell of rotten chum was in the water and all over your fingers and all over the boats. And we would be on these tiny one hopes being swayed one way or another. And I would always look to see where father was on the new hope and his special seat on the new hope. And you could barely see the silhouette of the New Hope, but you could tell it was there by the flashing lights of the mast going back and forth, and it was almost like an ominous metronome going back and forth with the waves. It would almost touch the water at each side, and every time there would be a lightning strike, it would illuminate all the beings on the boat. And I just remember there would be father with his line sitting on the top deck of the New Hope, and there would be Heung Jin in the middle of a pouring rain with his shirt off, a freezing rain, he would be there tending the lines. And this would go on for hours, 14 hours, 15 hours. But that's the spirit he was. Because while he was there, he understood complete attendance. You know, father said to love Heung Jin, or to embody his spirit is to attend to true parents. It's really true, you know. Even Jesus said, be like the servant waiting for the master, not knowing when he's going to show up. That was my brother Heung Jin Young. He was always there in readiness, ready to give his life, whether it was jumping in front of a knife or a bullet for my father. And that enormous sense of security that I felt with him as a young boy, I've never felt brotherhood this profound. You know, this silly story. I mean, my God, Heung Jin was just amazing what he would do with cars. You know, back in the day, He loved this one car. It was a staff car at East Garden, but he loved it because it was just a beast. It had the biggest engine and it was the fastest one at the time. And whatever had the word fast on it, he would love. And it was a 1977 Lincoln Mark V. And if you're old enough to remember what that thing was, it was a boat with two doors. But he loved it because it had a big 460 engine that was hot-rodded by one of the security guards. And I remember he terrorizing the small town of Irvington and Tarrytown with that car, avoiding the police and crashing through fields. And it was incredible. There's one time where, you know, we went to the movies late at night, and we were all jammed up in this car. It was Heung Jin Young and Hyun Jin and Kook Jin and a couple of other blessed children, and the thing could hold like 50 people. And and we were all kids. My God, I was only like 7 or 8, and just being out of the house past 9 o'clock was just the most exciting thing in the world for me. just to be out, like, oh my God, this is what freedom tastes like. And to see a PG-13 movie was like, oh, someone's gonna say damn it in this movie. It was such a risque thing. I mean, that was exciting enough. Well, I remember pulling up into the parking spot, and you know, Heung Jin was in the passenger seat, and he opened the door, and boom, he dinged the door of the guy next to him. And out stepped two enormous men who were like saying, you mother... And it just kept on going on and on. And Heung Jin, without missing a beat, walked right up to him and said, you watch what you say. That's my brother you're talking to. He was a 17-year-old kid, and these guys were literally three times his size. And they were just like, they just quietly went away. And it was one of those things where, as a 9-year-old kid, you're like, I have never seen any teenager do that to any adult in my life. It was the most profound moment. And then as we're walking, and it was like, his adrenaline was pumping. We're walking to the theater. He just leaned over to Hyun and just said, you shouldn't have done that, Hyun. He's like, oh, I didn't know. But that feeling that you had, you really felt you were in the hands of truly somebody who honestly cared for you and who didn't hesitate at all. He had, again, no filter when it came with confrontation or when it came to meeting new people. All he wanted to know was, did you love true parents? Regardless of where you're from or what color you were his brother. And I can attest to this. There were strangers in his room all the time. He really treated you like family. And in that beautiful sense, I can see why, you know, they say a star that burns twice as bright burns half as long. I can see why perhaps maybe Heavenly Father could have used him in the spirit world, because a spirit like that, somebody who was born with such enormous presence and care, probably wouldn't have survived in today's world. And I think that's a horrible commentary about the world we live in. You know, Heung Jin Young, to me, well, this story, this last story I'm going to tell you, it came from actually this a longtime African American member who, back in the early time of our church, it was, you know, he was it was after some big event in the New Yorker Hotel. And it was actually Reverend Oliver, was it? It was Reverend Oliver, Zachary Oliver. And he was just there. He was a young member himself. And, you know, Heung Jin was walking back with the True family back on the 30th floor of the New Yorker. And he was like, Heung Jin. Heung Jin was like, he's like, I want you to come and meet my parents. Can you meet my parents? Okay. And he walked down the hallway And he walked with, it was almost like he floated, because he had so much, he had no sense of self. And he sat down, he went into the room, he met his parents. He sat down and just sat down. And was completely present with everybody there. And, you know, you saw the pictures. He was a very handsome young man. Yeah. And after just several moments, he just leaned over and just said, are you done with me? And they're like, yes. He said, okay, I'm going to go now. Okay. And he got up as gracefully as he walked in, and he walked out of the room. And Reverend Oliver's mom just said, that was the most beautiful man I've ever seen in my life. And, you know, I think it would be a disservice for me to really neglect the point is, you know, we all have that. It pains me to think what the world or even my family would be like, you know, if he was still alive. Because he left a profound impact on all of us. You know, Heung Jin was, I really question, you know, if the family would be in this particular state of turmoil, if he was still living, you know. You know, they said there's a pattern to life. Your grandparents die, your parents die, and then your children die. And would you want it any other way? And true sadness comes from when that order is reversed. And it was, I remember even Father, as strong and as stoic as he had to be, you know, I would sometimes hear the sound of weeping coming from Father's room. Because when Father was there, you know, as a tradition, we would always say good night, you know. But Father never showed it. And I wonder if Heung Jin was alive today, you know, a brother who literally gave it all away, including his life, if he was alive today, would Heung Jin keep it all for himself? Or when I think about Heung Jin Young and I think about him standing near Father, I wonder if Kuk Jin would have ever left his post. And my heart grieves knowing that my younger brother, Heung Jin, would never know what an incredible man his brother was. But I do. And I live with that memory. And I live with that. And I honor him by not trying to be like him. You know, when he passed so many blessed children, he had his own unique style. They would dress like him and listen to the music, try to be as much like him, but that misses the point. They miss the essence of him. And I hope that essence never gets lost as we remember this day. Because what he had within him that came out so naturally, we all have. But we don't give ourselves permission to act on it. And I wonder, thinking back, if you had a death sentence and you knew that you were only going to live for another year, and you truly accepted that you will die within a year, how will you treat the people in your lives, knowing that you'll never be able to return or say goodbye to them? How will you treat people you meet on the street, the cashier at the grocery store, you know, the smelly guy at the gym?
the person in church that you can't stand, or even witnessing on the street, he can part a room without saying a word. Can you? So I really wish and pray that we all embody him. I hope that we can awaken that part of him that lies dormant in all of us. Be truly accepting to everyone we meet, but also have tremendous strength and courage to overcome your fears, whether it be of death or self-preservation, and truly attend our true parents as if it was your last days on earth. That's a very high standard that he set. But these were my role models when I grew up. And these were my brothers. And I'm very sad to see them go. But in that sense, they are the greatest teachers. I'm going to change things up a little bit. That's very heavy, and I apologize, but this day was 30 years in the making. You know, growing up, we couldn't really grieve. But now, as an adult, and I'm looking back on his life and I'm thinking about who I became as a man, I go, wow, it was, you know, Einstein said it himself. He said, the only reason why I could see so far is that I stood on the shoulders of giants. And Heung Jin Nim, Heung Jin Nim, even my younger brother, Heung Jin, they all had things to teach me. And I honor them by not doing what they did, but becoming who they were. If you do that, you will be true parents. I'd like to dedicate this song to my brother. When I am down and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, but I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raised me up so I could stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I could stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up to more than I can be. Thank you, brothers and sisters.
Most beloved Father, thank you for this day you have given us. So much suffering your son has gone through. All of us wish we could love like you, like that, Father, every day of our life. We have not given our 100% to you for true parents. Now that we have learned more, Father, let this enter into our soul and our motivation, Father, and keep us close together. Satan tries to come and separate our family. Father, but now we have more reason to keep strong. Everywhere we go, we see your children suffering, Father. 6,000 years you have been weeping, looking at your children suffering. Yet, you cannot do anything, Father, until your children can do something about it. Please help these members, Father. Please forgive them. Please understand that we try our best, that it is difficult for all of us. We repent most deeply from the bottom of our heart and pray that you may accept our repentance once again. From this day, from this moment, we can start a new leaf, Father. We want to hear the name of sons and daughters of you and proudly call true parents, Father. I shall never leave you, Father. I shall always be with you, Father. We all love you very much. Please give us one more chance to prove it. You have suffered enough. You have suffered more than you deserve to. Let us take your burden, Father. Let us take your suffering. All of us are grateful. All this we pray in the name of our most beloved true parents. Amen.